Almighty and merciful Lord grant you absolution and remission of all your sins, true repentance, amendment of life, and the grace and consolation of his Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, whose blessed Son was led by the Spirit to be tempted by Satan, come quickly to help us who are assaulted by many temptations. And as you know, the weakness of each of us, let each one find you mighty to save through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
A lesson from the book of Genesis. God said to Noah and to his sons with him, "As for me, I am establishing my covenant with you and your descendants after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the domestic animals, and every animal of the earth with you, as many as came out of the ark. I establish my covenant with you that never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of a flood. And never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth." God said, "This is the sign of the covenant that I make between you and me and you and every living creature that is with you for all future generations. I have set my bow in the clouds, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth and the bow is seen in the clouds, I will remember my covenant that is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And the waters shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. When the bow is in the clouds, I will see it, and remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is on the earth." God said to Noah, "This is the sign of the covenant that I have established between me and all flesh that is on the earth." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 25. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. My God, I put my trust in you.
Let me not be humiliated, nor let my enemies triumph over me. Let none who look to you be put to shame. Let the treacherous be disappointed in their schemes. Show me your ways, O Lord, and teach me your paths. Lead me your truth, and teach me, for you are the God of my salvation. In you have I trusted all the day long. Remember, O Lord, your compassion and love, for they are from everlasting. Remember not the sins of my youth and my transgressions. Remember me according to your love, and for the sake of your goodness, O Lord. Gracious and upright is the Lord, therefore he teaches sinners in his way. He guides the humble in doing right, and he teaches his way to the lowly. All the paths of the Lord are love and faithfulness to those who keep his covenant and his testimonies.
A lesson from the letter of Peter. Christ suffered for sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, in order to bring you to God. He was put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which also he went and made a proclamation to the spirits in prison, who in former times did not obey when God waited patiently in the days of Noah, during the building of the ark, in which a few, that is, eight persons, were saved through water. And baptism, which this prefigured, now saves you, not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, with angels, authorities, and powers made subject to him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." And the Spirit immediately drove him into the wilderness. He was in the wilderness 40 days, tempted by Satan, and he was with the wild beasts, and the angels waited on him. Now after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Lent always begins with Jesus in the wilderness. Every year on this first Sunday of Lent, we encounter one or another of the stories of Jesus immediately following his baptism, being driven into the wilderness and there to be tempted by the Satan. His hair still dripping with water from the River Jordan and his baptism at the hands of his kinsman John, the very same Spirit that descends upon him in the form of a dove then propels him into the wilderness for this 40-day time of testing and trial and challenge. In fact, the Greek word that is translated as "he was driven" is the same as "hurled like a javelin." So it's not like Jesus sort of perambulated, sort of meandered his way in the wilderness. He was thrust into the wilderness straight from the baptism. Remember what happened with the baptism? The dove descends and the voice of God says, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." Jesus doesn't get to enjoy that. He doesn't get to put his feet back and say, "All right, this is sweet." I mean, any of us, after we receive a compliment or we achieve something significant, we like to bask in the glow, don't we? We like to enjoy the accolade or the moment. We like to revel in the glory of the occasion. Jesus doesn't get that luxury. Instead, he's hurled into the wilderness. And there he is tempted. He's with the wild beasts, all by himself, and tempted by the adversary. We've all heard this story 100 times. We've all encountered it in one way or another countless times in our lives. But did you notice what is missing in Mark's version of the temptation story? The temptations. He doesn't articulate exactly what it is that Jesus was tempted to do or not to do by the devil. In Matthew, we get the details. He's tempted to throw himself from the pinnacle of the temple and angels will catch him. He is tempted to turn stones into bread, tempted to offer allegiance to the Satan in order to receive power over all the nations of the earth. Mark doesn't give us those specifics. We may hear them when we hear Mark's story, Mark's version, but Mark leaves it more amorphous, more ambiguous, and simply says he was tempted. I don't know about you, but I find that an approach to which I can relate more easily and which ultimately is a little more intimidating. The explicit nature of the temptations as articulated in the other Gospels don't really affect me. I'm never going to be tempted to throw myself from the pinnacle of Holy Comforter. I'm never going to be tempted to turn, you know, stones into bread, because I can't. Neither can you. But the sort of amorphous, ambiguous, opaque temptation, that I can relate to. Because we all, in one way or another, tempted, aren't we? And what is a temptation? It's a lie. It's a deceit. It's a prevarication. It's an attempt to have us believe something that isn't true. Or even sometimes to do the right thing, but for the wrong purpose, the wrong reason. A temptation is always something that leads us away from who we truly are, who we know ourselves fully to be. And surely that is the sort of temptations that Jesus faced. Whether or not it included hurling himself from the temple, the reality is he was surely tempted in the wilderness to be less, not more, less than he really was. And isn't that the power of temptation? Not to try to puff ourselves up, but in fact, to take the easy way out, to take the cheap way out, to take the way of glory or fame or whatever it might be, to be less than who we are. And I think that's what surely Jesus faced by the adversary. The temptation to show that he was the Son of God by not acting like the Son of God. To show that he had all of this power and authority by acting as if he didn't. Or was he able to hand it off to somebody else? To be less, not more. And that's the temptation we face. The temptation we face as the children of God, forget who we are. To take the easy way out, the flashy way, the cheap way, whatever it might be. To forget our identity as children of God, as sisters and brothers to each other, as friends and spouses and parents and employees, to be less. So that, in terms of today's story, that is something I can relate to. I have to tell you, when the alarm went off this morning, about 17% of me wanted to call Derek and Carter and Heath and say, I'm not coming in today. I don't have a sermon. I've been doing this since I was 5 years old. I'm done. I'm going to sleep in. You know, Jan can come over and film the service, but I'm going to stay home. I mean, that temptation was there. I mean, I have to admit, it was there, 17%, and I overcame it. The temptation to be less. The other thing that strikes me about this particular episode is, where does it take place? In the wilderness. Now, when I say the word wilderness, what probably comes to your mind is the Judean desert in which Jesus was propelled. Or maybe you think about some other barren location in the southwestern United States or Africa or somewhere. But the wilderness, ultimately, is anywhere where the familiar, where the known, where the comfortable is taken away, where the things that prop us up, that support us in our daily lives, where that is removed and we find ourselves vulnerable and maybe alone, without those familiar patterns and rhythms and standards. And in that regard, does not sound like where we are right now. In our world, in our culture, maybe in our own lives. But even when there isn't a pandemic going on, we all encounter the wilderness in one way or another on a regular basis. It might not be a barren desert, but that place, that time, that feeling where we're alone or we're isolated or we're vulnerable or the familiar has been taken away from us. The wilderness can be the waiting room in a hospital. It can be the hotel with the cheap sheets when we've had to leave our house because of a fire or burst pipes, as has happened to so many this week in Texas. The wilderness can be not being able to find our car in the parking lot when we've lost our job. The wilderness can be hearing on the phone words we do not want to hear. We all of us spend time in the wilderness, maybe not 40 days, maybe not a barren desert, but times and moments and feelings where we do have knocked out from under us the things that normally hold us up and prop us. And that's when we're most vulnerable to temptation, to the lie, to the deceit, to the enticement and seduction to be less. version of the temptation in the wilderness is more powerful because of the ambiguity, because it reminds me that Jesus is the one who understands. Isn't that the entire arc of his life and ministry? Born just like us. Grew up in a faith community, in a family, in a community, in a neighborhood, just as we did. Learned a trade, went to work just as we did. Faced temptation and challenges to his identity as the Holy One of God, just as we do. And ultimately died, just as we do. The one who at every level of our humanity understands and resonates, not as some purely divine figure who is not vulnerable to temptation, but as one who works through it and remains true to who he is, the Holy One of God, just as we are called to remain true to who we are, the Holy Ones of God, the children of God, sisters and brothers to each other. Here we are, just a few days into the season of Lent. And for centuries, this has been seen as a dour and somber, solemn season. And indeed, it is a somber time. But it's not, to my way of thinking, a season in which we are called to beat up on ourselves, only to be self-critical. We have enough of that in our lives already, don't we? Yes, that's part of the journey, I suppose, to be honest about who we are. But Lent ultimately has within it the reminder that the one who understands is walking with us in the wilderness, walking with us as we face temptation and seduction, deception and lie, that we are not going through this journey alone, that the one who was baptized as we were baptized, the one who lived as we live, is with us. And that makes Lent, to me, a time, yes, somber, yes, self-reflective, yes, but a time ultimately to remember that we journey with the one who knows us, who understands us, who's faced temptation, who has faced the call to be less, to take the easy way, to cheat, to take the cheap road. Enticements we all face in our various wildernesses. And so as we move more deeply into this season, never forget that we do so in the company of the one who has lived the life we live, who has faced the enticements we face, the one who remained true to his identity and calls us to remain true to our identity as the children of God, as beloved of God, as beloved of one another, as sisters and brothers to each other. The one who understands.
come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end.
We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life,
who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken to the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray. I ask your prayers for God's people throughout the world, for our presiding Bishop Michael, our Bishop-elect Paula, for this gathering, and for all ministers and lay people. Pray for the church. I ask your prayers for peace, for goodwill among nations, and for the well-being of all people. Pray for justice and peace, remembering especially all those who serve in the armed forces and their families. I ask your prayers for the poor, the sick, the hungry, the oppressed, and those in prison. Pray for those in any need or trouble. I ask your prayers for all who seek God or a deeper knowledge of God. Pray that they may find and be found by him. I ask your prayers for the departed, especially the faithful departed of this parish and of our own lives. Pray for those who have died. I ask your prayers for those on our parish prayer list, especially Barb, Marty, Cindy, John, Frank, Marilyn, Andrew, Louise, Vince, and Gretchen. We also pray for Aaron, for Betsy, Megan, for Bill, Jill, Jim, Hal, Sam, and Susie. We hold up to God Linda, Bill, Earl, and Arden, Dylan, Donna, Nick, and Robin, as we also pray for Christopher, Casey, for Margot, Patty, Don, for David, Clara, Elizabeth, and Mary. We pray for John, for Pam, Bruce, Harriet, Kristen, Roger, Marilyn, Peggy, and for those in your hearts. I ask your thanksgivings for all the blessings we receive from God, and today we give special thanks to the birthday of Christy Arditi. I ask your prayers for Holy Family Ministries, one of the care and compassion organizations Holy Comforter supports. Praise God for those in every generation in whom Christ has been honored. Pray that we may have grace to glorify Christ in our own day. Amen. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Thank you.
after this Eucharist, a reminder that we will reinstate the adult forum today as we did it last fall, every other week. And Carter is going to be beginning a three-part series today on the letter to the Romans, that seminal work that's been so influential for nearly 2,000 years, Paul's magisterial work, his letter. So I hope you will stay, or you will stay on the stream for that, which will begin right after the service. We'll have a little bit of transition as people leave or arrive or change clothes or whatever the case might be. But that will run about 10 o'clock today, in 2 weeks, and in a month. So I hope you'll stay and join us, again, either on screen or in person. Reminder as well that on Mondays and Fridays, members of our lay Eucharistic ministry team offer morning prayer on Zoom, 8 o'clock, only Monday and Friday. You might remember that they offered it every day during the week, during Advent, but during Lent, we're doing it on Monday and Friday. The link for that is in the bulletin, and I will send that out probably again later today. I hope you'll join the Lens on Monday and Friday for that beautiful and ancient rite. It's a wonderful way to begin a Lenten morning. And a reminder as well that on Wednesdays at 7 o'clock in the evening, Carter leads a contemplative evening prayer, again on Zoom. So on Mondays, we have morning prayer. On Tuesday, the Eucharist. On Wednesday, evening prayer. On Thursday, early, the Eucharist. On Friday, morning prayer. Saturday, the Eucharist. So every day, there's an opportunity to worship and grow and be nourished during this Lenten time. On Thursday evenings, we will begin, on this Thursday evening, we will begin our Lenten series. We are not, of course, going to try to replicate real spirituality that Father Chris did for about 9 years. This is going to be a one-hour session for four Thursdays on Zoom, titled In the Wilderness. Very appropriate, given our gospel and maybe the homily today. We'll talk about biblical wilderness, about historical and spiritual wilderness, and about the wildernesses we all have known. The information for that, again, is in the bulletin for Thursday evening. I encourage you or invite you to join me for this session. This first session on Thursday night. There's one other notice, the very last one, in the bulletin announcements, but I'm going to have Heath mention that instead.
Just wanted to make sure everybody knows that on our website there's a variety of things you can do during Lent at home or during the week, and one of them in particular is an offering created by Kim Picos, which is a booklet that hard copies will be available here this week, but you can also get it online. And it has a variety of spiritual practices or disciplines that you can choose during this time if you're looking for a new way to honor the season of Lent. So it's a wonderful work that Kim has given to us, so thank you. And I encourage you to take a look.
Walk in love, as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who was tempted in every way as we are, yet did not sin. By his grace we are able to triumph over evil and to live no longer for ourselves alone, but for him who died for us and rose again. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy, 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 holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death,
we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming glory.
And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with all your saints we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
O Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world.
Have mercy on us. O Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. O Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Grant us peace.
Please join me now on page 9, the prayer of spiritual communion. My loving Lord, I believe that you are truly present in the blessed sacrament of the altar.
I cherish you above all things and long for you in my soul. Since I cannot receive you in the sacrament of your body and blood, come spiritually into my heart. Cleanse and strengthen me with your grace, Lord Jesus, and let me never be separated from you. May I live in you.
go in